Good morning, folks.
Morning.
Welcome to Mount Vernon. Glad y'all are here. Certainly a blessing to be in God's house, and Lord's given us another day, so we need to be thankful. I want to report that we did have a successful self-defense class yesterday, or as I say we, the women did. 27 there. So they are ready for anything, so don't come at them with any kind of offensiveness, because they will defend themselves. And they learned how to defend themselves yesterday. We're going to learn how to defend ourselves tonight in our faith, and we have an apologetics night tonight. So questions have come in. There'll be also time for questions from the floor, but I look forward to that tonight, so you guys make your plans to be here. Don't forget, on Wednesday night, still working through the book of John, here in the sanctuary, older and younger youth meeting, 5:30 for meal, 6:30 for the service. Our older youth, we will be meeting at the Thompson's house, not this Wednesday, but the next Wednesday, for a pool party and pizza and fellowship there. That'll be July the 5th, so see if we can splash all the water out of Kevin and Caitlin's pool there at the Thompson's house. Keep giving to the Women's Center. Donations are good through June here. We'll keep filling up the table. And this Sunday night, we'll be having a fellowship following the service. I don't know if that's a shorter service, but after the service, we'll be having fellowship, as well as some time together to eat and all after the service on July the 2nd. So keep praying for James Benet. He did have to have surgery on his collarbone. I hate to say that, but he is on the mend, and I told him to keep drinking his milk and see if he can get those bones to grow together. But pray for James Benet, healing there. Eva Reese, want to keep praying for Miss Eva. Alyssa Wynn as well. Anne Herna's mother is in Memorial Hospital. They're looking for a rehab clinic somewhere nearby, so keep praying for Miss Anne and her mother, Miss Patricia. Also, Hilda Lowry is another name. This is Rick Herna's aunt, Sister Hazel's sister. That's hard to say. Sister Hazel's sister, Hilda Lowry. She had heart cath, went in for that, ended up coming out with a pacemaker. And so please keep her in your prayers. Leslie Griffiths doing some better. He's had a time since his gallbladder surgery. So keep praying for Leslie and his healing. And David Sellers was another name given to me. Been diagnosed with cancer and in a lot of pain this morning. So be praying for David Sellers. But plenty of folks, I'm sure there's unspoken and ones we don't know about. But y'all be praying one for another. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear God, we just praise you, Lord, as we gather today, Lord, to lift up the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, Jesus Christ. God, we thank you that we are able to do this. Lord, we in the country we live in, the freedoms that we have, we thank you for that as we look forward to the 4th of July and the celebration of our independence. God, we just thank you, Lord, for salvation that we can have through Christ. And Lord, I pray if one's come this way that knows you not as Lord and Savior, Lord, today would be the day of salvation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you, choir. Let's look for each other around the throne. When the morning comes, let's stand together today. Let's sing together this morning. We'll understand it better by and by. Let's lift him up today.
Trials dark on every hand, and we cannot understand all the ways that God would lead us to that blessed promised land. But he'll guide us with his eye, and we'll follow till we die. We will understand it better by and by.
God, we just thank you today that we can sing about heaven. Lord, we know that the assurance is there, Lord, that you've promised us a home. And we just thank you for that. We can celebrate it today. Thank you for the peace that we have in knowing Jesus. Lord, bless us as we just continue to worship today, lift you up. And Lord, just speak to those that just need a touch from you right now as we worship in Jesus' name. Amen. Stay standing with us. Let's sing today. We're no longer slaves today because he set us free. Been delivered, born again. He's the day we know.
Will you unravel me with a melody and surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies? I am a child of God.
Father, thank you, Lord, today for your grace. It is greater than all our sin, Lord, that covers our sin, God, that washes us clean. Lord, thank you that you loved us that much, that you went to the cross, that you died in our place so that we could have eternal life, Lord. Just pray that today as we give back in these tithes and offerings, we'll honor you as we give today, and we'll give you glory, and we'll do all that will please you through it, Lord, that help others to know about you in Jesus' name. Amen. As you're being seated, let's sing that chorus one more time.
Praise, praise God.
Chance today to welcome somebody, tell them you're glad to see them. Our kids are going to go back out to kids worship. Y'all had a week off last week, kids, so we expect y'all to keep Brother Cole entertained today, keep him awake back there this morning, and give kids a chance to go out. You tell somebody you're glad to see him as they play for you this morning.
Protection while we sleep. We pray for healing, for prosperity. We pray for your mighty hand to ease our suffering. And all the while you hear each spoken need, yet love us way too much to give us lesser things. What if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your tears. What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? And what if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? We pray for wisdom, your voice to hear, and we cry out in anger when we cannot feel you near. We doubt your goodness, we doubt your love, as if every promise from your word is not enough.
What a wonderful reminder that is, to know that God is in control, and that even in our darkest moments, you know, folks, many times we seem to think that God doesn't answer our prayers, when the reality is that sometimes He just says no. And the reason for that is because He knows better, and He knows what's best for us. Amen? So thank you for that wonderful reminder this morning. It is so good to see you all here today. Our main passage can be found in the book 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verses 1 through 19. 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verses 1 through 19. 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verses 1 through 19. If you're able, I invite you to please stand in reverence of the reading of God's Word. Pursue love, yet desire earnestly spiritual gifts, but especially that you may prophesy. For one who speaks in a tongue does not speak to men, but to God. For no one understands, but in his spirit he speaks mysteries. But one who prophesies speaks to men for edification and exhortation and consolation. One who speaks in a tongue edifies himself, but one who prophesies edifies the church. Now I wish that you all spoke in tongues, but even more that you would prophesy. And greater is one who prophesies than one who speaks in tongues, unless he interprets, so that the church may receive edifying. But now, brethren, if I come to you speaking in tongues, what will I profit you unless I speak to you either by way of revelation, or of knowledge, or of prophecy, or of teaching? Yet even lifeless things, either flute or harp, in producing a sound, if they do not produce a distinction in the tones, how will it be known what is played on the flute or the harp? For if the bugle produces an indistinct sound, who will prepare himself for battle? So also you, unless you utter by the tongue speech that is clear, how will it be known what is spoken? For you will be speaking into the air. There are perhaps a great many kinds of languages in the world, and no kind is without meaning. If then I do not know the meaning of the language, I will be to the one who speaks a barbarian, and the one who speaks will be a barbarian to me. So also you, since you are zealous of spiritual gifts, seek to abound for the edification of the church. Therefore, let the one who speaks in a tongue pray that he may interpret. For if I pray in a tongue, my spirit prays, but my mind is unfruitful. What is the outcome then? I will pray with the spirit, and I will pray with the mind also. I will sing with the spirit, and I will sing with the mind also. Otherwise, if you bless in the spirit only, how will the one who fills the place of the ungifted say the amen at your giving thanks, since he does not know what you are saying? For you are giving thanks well enough, but the other person is not edified. I thank God I speak in tongues more than you all. However, in church I desire to speak 5 words with my mind, so that I may instruct others also, rather than 10,000 words in a tongue. Let us pray. Dear gracious and heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much. God, I thank you for allowing us to come here today to worship your holy name. God, I pray that we would always live knowing that we are your children. Father, that we would always live glorifying you and seeking to honor you in everything that we do. I pray that we would always live reverently towards you and yet in the comfort of knowing that you are our Father. Lord, I thank you so much for leading the people of this church. And I pray, Father, that as we come to your word, that the Holy Spirit that is inside all of your children would allow us to come to a proper interpretation. Father, that we may be edified, that we may be equipped to evangelize. Lord, we love you and we praise you. God, we thank you for the forgiveness of sins. And Lord, I pray that you would forgive me of mine. Lord God, let your message be made known. And in the name of Jesus, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, I do pray these things. Amen. You may be seated. As we go through this passage, we're going to examine very closely what the spiritual gift of tongues is. And I believe why this is important is because out of all the spiritual gifts, I believe tongues is the one that is the most misunderstood and therefore the most misused within the church. So we're going to examine what the Bible has to say about the gift of tongues. Before we get to that, did you know that the same sentence that has the same words in the same places can have multitudes of meanings depending on the inflections and the tone of voice? Let me give you an example. Grandma hit a deer with her car. Very straightforward sentence, right? Watch this. Grandma hit a deer with her car? Now it's a question. Now watch this. Grandma hit a deer with her car? It didn't just bump into her. You're saying that grandma hit a deer with her car? She didn't hit a dog or a person? You're saying that grandma hit a deer with her car and not her truck? Same words in the same order, and yet each sentence means something different. Each sentence has a different meaning. Likewise, I can still say a sentence and I can bring it forth to you in such a way that it will still have different meanings. For instance, I could say, Grandma hit a deer with her car. And you know by my body language that what I'm implying there. But if I come to you and say, Hey, Grandma hit a deer with her car, then I'm worried, right? Same sentence, same places, but different meanings. Parker, why are you talking about this? Because, folks, when things are written down, we don't get those inflections. How many of you have been accused of saying something that you did not say because you texted somebody and they misinterpreted the tone of your text? I have. It's easy to do that because you don't get tone in a text. You don't get tone in what is written down. You don't get inflections in what is written down. So what you have to do is you have to take what is written down and you have to examine the entire context of the situation to come to a proper understanding of what is being said. For instance, in this passage that we just read, if we don't take into account any context or any understanding of the time or who Paul is writing to, or why he is writing, then we would come to this text and we would come to the understanding that tongues is an unintelligible language that nobody else understands, and that praying in a tongue edifies ourselves. Indeed, many people have come to that interpretation. But if we just examine this text without the tone, without the inflections, and without the context, my fear is that we have come to, unfortunately, a great misunderstanding of what Paul is actually saying here as he's writing to the Corinthian church. I want to point out that the reason why Paul is addressing this in 1 Corinthians, and he addresses this for a while in chapter 12, chapter 13, chapter 14, and on into chapter 15 as well. The reason why he's addressing this is because the Corinthian church, they were what Paul would describe as being zealous of spiritual gifts, meaning that they thought that it was exciting, that it was excitable for them to be involved in these spiritual things. And many of them in the Corinthian church had come out of pagan roots. You got to remember, in Corinth at the time, Corinth was kind of a trading hub where all these different cultures came and meshed together. And so some in the Corinthian church weren't even Jews, but they came from pagan roots, and they left those pagan practices, and those pagan practices were hyper-spiritual, ecstatic practices, and they were trying to bring that into the church. They're trying to worship the true God the same way that they worshiped their false God. And so Paul was having to address what the purpose of spiritual gifts is. If you're going to desire for spiritual gifts, if you're going to be zealous for spiritual gifts, then I pray that you are zealous for the right spiritual gifts and for the right reasons. That is why Paul is writing this, and that is why he is addressing this. But my point is that without context, without tone, without inflection, it is very difficult to determine the true meaning of a text if you don't take into account the context. So when we look at this, earnestly desire the spiritual gifts, but especially that you may prophesy, for one who speaks in a tongue. Let's talk about this word tongue here for just a second. Tongue comes from the Greek word glossa, and it's used to either mean the physical tongue that's in your mouth, or it's used to mean language. It is used to mean actual human languages. For instance, the glossa of the Jewish people is Hebrew. Do you understand? So glossa literally translates to language. The plural of that is glossais. Before we tackle this passage, I want us to first examine the purpose of spiritual gifts as a whole. Before we get into the purpose of tongues, why tongues is given, I want us to look at the whole purpose. Why do we even have spiritual gifts? Why did God grant spiritual gifts to members of the church? By the way, if you are in here and you are saved and the Holy Spirit abides inside of you, you have a specific spiritual gift. You do. And my prayer is that if you don't know what that is, that you pray and you study and you come to an understanding of what it is, but not without context. Before we tackle this passage, let us examine the purpose of spiritual gifts as a whole. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7, just to hop and a skip over, 1 Corinthians 12, verse 7, it says, "But to each one is given the manifestation of the Spirit." What's those next few words there? "For the common good." "But to each one is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good." Look again at 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 10, as it says this, "As each one has received a special gift, employ it in serving one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God." Most oftentimes, whenever spiritual gifts are referenced or mentioned in Scripture, it is in close proximity to the teaching of us as the body of Christ, and individually members of it. Folks, what we're reading about spiritual gifts is that spiritual gifts is not for the purpose of the self, is not for the purpose of the one who has it, but it is for the common good. It is for the advancement and the edification of the church. It is for our collective good. It is for building one another up. It is for encouraging one another. The hand, my hand, does not exist or act for the sake of the hand. Rather, my hand exists and acts for the sake of the body. Likewise, my eye. My eye does not exist and act for the sake of the eye, but it exists and acts for the sake of the body. If I had just an eye, and that's all I was focused on, I would be useless. Sure, I could see things coming at me, but I could do nothing to catch them or stop them or go after them. Only a complete body that has hands and eyes and fingers and toes and feet, only a complete body working in unison can be effective to accomplish a task. You and I, brothers and sisters, have been given a task, and that task is to go and make disciples of all nations. When Jesus gave that command, he wasn't going to leave us without tools in which we could accomplish that goal. But I want it to be made known that there is not one iota of Scripture that suggests that spiritual gifts are given to us for our own good, or to make us feel good, or for our own edification. Spiritual gifts are given for all of us to help and encourage and edify one another, and to go out and evangelize. That is the whole purpose of spiritual gifts. Spiritual gifts are not given for us to have hyper-spiritual ecstatic experiences. You see, some of these people on TV shows, and I'm sure most of us have heard of Benny Hinn, and you watch it and you almost want to laugh and cry at the same time, because he claims that, you know, his spiritual gifts is throwing his hands down on this side, and everybody over here falls down. And then he comes over here and throws his hands over here, and everybody over there falls down. Everybody's having an exciting experience. Everybody's having a wonderful time. And yet that gift is useless. God does not give us useless gifts, brothers and sisters. He gives us gifts to edify the body and to advance the kingdom of God. So, if that's the point of spiritual gifts as a whole, to edify the body and to advance the kingdom of God, what does the Bible teach us about tongues? We see in this instance that Paul is addressing tongues. You may notice the tone, though, that Paul is not addressing tongues in a good light. So what does the Bible tell us the purpose or the goodness of tongues? Where can we read about the point? Why did God give us tongues? Just look over real quick in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 22, and we see a hint. 1 Corinthians 14, 22, listen to what he says here. So then tongues are for a sign, not to those who believe, but to unbelievers. Let's stop right there. Tongues is not for the believers. So remember when we go back and we say that spiritual gifts serve two purposes. It's either for the edification of the church or for the advancement of the kingdom of God. If tongues is not for the edification of the church, then that leaves one, brothers and sisters. That means that tongues is for the advancement of the kingdom of God. That tongues is a gift given to us to go reach unbelievers to the early church. Look at this. In Acts chapter 2, verses 4 through 6, we see on the day of Pentecost the introduction of the gift of tongues. This is one of the first gifts that we see of the Holy Spirit given to people as a permanent indwelling. Acts chapter 2, verses 4 through 6, and then jump over to verse 11, it says this. And suddenly there came from heaven a noise like a violent rushing wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. And there appeared to them tongues as of fire distributing themselves, and they rested on each one of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit was giving them utterance. Now most people would want us to stop right there. I remember one time Nicole and I, we were sitting in a CC's Pizza, and I'll never forget this moment. But this boy walks up to me, and I couldn't tell you why he walked up to me. I think Nicole and I were having a gospel conversation, and he heard it. And he came and he told me a little bit about his testimony and his background, and he said that he came from a Pentecostal church, a church of God. And he said that they always preached that up to that point to show us that we have the gift of tongues, to show us that we have been, he said, that we are on fire for the Lord, that we have a fire within us to go and speak tongues. But he said what led him out of that church was one day he was sitting in there and he decided to read the rest of the passage. So brothers and sisters, I encourage you, read the rest of the passage. If I'm ever teaching something that contradicts with the rest of the passage, I want you to tell me. Okay? Can we make that deal? All right. So let's read the rest of the passage. Let's start in verse 5. Now there were Jews living in Jerusalem, devout men from every nation under heaven. And when this sound occurred, the crowd came together and were bewildered because each one of them was hearing them speak in what? In his own language. When the disciples began to speak in tongues on the day of Pentecost, listen to me, it was not incoherent babbling. It was not just repetitive syllables. It wasn't. On the day of Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit descended on the disciples for a permanent indwelling, and they began to speak in tongues, everybody who was there understood them. Everybody. That tells you and me, brothers and sisters, that we collectively as a church throughout all the denominations have severely mishandled and misinterpreted what the gift of tongues is. Tongues was an evangelical tool meant to fulfill the Great Commission. When Jesus gave his disciples the Great Commission, right before he ascended into heaven, he said, go and make disciples of all nations. Okay, hold on a second. How on earth were they going to go and make disciples of all nations? They weren't, you know, Jesus, in our standards, Jesus didn't pick the cream of the crop people to follow him. They couldn't speak multiple languages, let alone the language of every nation. So how on earth were these disciples going to tell the gospel to these people of all of these different languages if they themselves could not speak the language? I'm going to tell you how. The gift of tongues. The gift of tongues was given so that somebody who wanted to preach the gospel to another people in a language that they did not know, they would be able to do so. It would be kind of like if I as a missionary back in the day went over to China in order to deliver the gospel to the Chinese, but I don't know any Chinese, okay? And yet I still feel that the impression of the Holy Spirit to go and share the gospel, the Holy Spirit would then empower me to speak Chinese. There is nowhere in Scripture that asserts that glossa is anything other than human languages, than spoken human languages. So it was an evangelical tool meant to help fulfill the Great Commission. Okay, so Parker, if spiritual gifts are for our collective edification and evangelism, then why does Paul say here in verse 2 of chapter 14, for one who speaks in a tongue does not speak to men but to God? And why does he say in verse 14, for if I pray in a tongue, my spirit prays, but my mind is unfruitful? If tongues is so that you can speak a language that somebody else does not speak, and it's for evangelism, then why is Paul here saying that when you pray in a tongue, you pray only to God? Well, let's go back to what I said at the very beginning. Remember what I said about tones? Remember what I said about the fluctuations? How we don't really hear that in the text, but we have to bring the context in, together in order to make it understand? When we bring in the context that tongues is a sign gift for non-believers, in other words, it's an evangelical tool, if tongues is for that reason, in context, and the Bible does not contradict itself, then we must understand that Paul is not giving them instruction about how to speak in tongues. He's not giving them instruction, when you speak in tongues, make sure you do this. He's pointing out something that they are doing wrong. He's pointing out how they are misusing the gift of tongues. See, notice the language here. He says, he doesn't say, make sure you do this. He says, for one who speaks in a tongue does not speak to men, but to God, for no one understands him, but in his spirit he speaks mysteries. He's telling them that the person who is in that church, because remember, he is addressing a church, the person who is speaking in a tongue in that church is speaking a language that nobody knows. And then when you read the rest of the passage and you read the tone of Paul's voice, he's not putting speaking in tongues in the church in a very positive light. Saying when you speak in a tongue, nobody understands you. Nobody knows what you're saying. Remember, Paul is not giving instructions. He is pointing out how they are mistreating the gift of tongues. Tongues is always something that is accompanied with an interpretation. When we go and we read the list, remember when it lists spiritual gifts and it says the gift of tongues? Right after that, it says the gift of interpretation. Okay? Tongues is always accompanied with interpretation, meaning somebody who understands the language, somebody that can translate. Tongues has its evangelical purpose. But listen to me, and I hope I don't push any of you out. I hope I haven't pushed you out yet. It has its evangelical purpose, but it is not useful in the church. It is or was useful on the mission field. But when we gather corporately, and that's what Paul's addressing here. If you want proof of that, look at the last part of our text for today in verse 19, or starting at verse 18. He says, I thank God I speak in tongues more than you all. So Paul is addressing that he does speak in tongues. But notice what he says in verse 19. However, in the church I desire to speak five words with my mind so that I may instruct others also rather than 10,000 words in a tongue. And this goes beautifully with the reality that tongues is for evangelism. If tongues is for evangelism, and if tongues is so that you can speak a language that nobody here knows, then it really isn't useful in the church. Let me tell you something, brothers and sisters. If I got up here and I preached a sermon in Chinese, I'm going to keep saying Chinese, by the way, and I'll tell you why, because it's popping in my head. And I preached a sermon in Chinese, okay? And it could have been probably my greatest sermon. It had the greatest analogies. I pulled out the greatest scripture. And I was passionate. It would have done nothing to edify you. It would have been completely useless. You might have sat there to yourself thinking, yeah, he's pretty good. But yet the sermon that I have prepared, if I preach it to you in Chinese, it does nothing to edify you. And so tongues improperly used in a service is useless. In fact, Paul goes on to instruct them later. He says, if you must pray in tongues in church, make sure it's done one at a time and somebody interprets. Otherwise, keep silent. How many churches do we know that believe in praying in tongues, and yet everybody's doing it at once? Tongues is always something accompanied by an interpretation so that it is useful. Now, with all of this context, let's look at the passage. Verse 1 of chapter 14, he says, pursue love. Firstly, Paul puts a great emphasis on love. Sometimes I think we brush over that. And maybe for some of us who are maturing in our faith, love has kind of become a wince word. We don't really like it. But love is actually a beautiful thing that we need to hold on to when we understand what love is. Remember, we talked recently about what love is. And love is beautiful. Love is precious. Love should be the driving force of every single one of you in here, of why you do what you do. Notice what Paul says in chapter 13, verses 1 through 7. This is, if you've ever had a wedding in here, I'm sure that you've probably used this passage. If I speak with tongues of men and of angels, but do not have love, I have become a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and know all the mysteries of all knowledge, but I have all the faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all my possessions to feed the poor, and if I surrender my body to be burned, but do not have love, it profits me nothing. Love is patient, love is kind, and is not jealous. Love does not brag and is not arrogant, does not act unbecomingly, it does not seek its own, it's not provoked, it does not take into account a wrong suffered, does not rejoice in unrighteousness, but rejoices with the truth, bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things, and of course, the beginning of verse 8, love never fails. I know that was at my wedding. So Paul thinks very highly of love. Paul wants the people to pursue. He wants them to stop pursuing these hyper-ecstatic experiences. He wants them to leave the pagan faith behind. And he wants them to pursue, to earnestly desire love. And then spiritual gifts actually works its way in there. Like I said, love should be the driving motivation for the Christian life. Love to God, love for the brethren, and love for the lost. Listen to me. When we love one another, we serve one another, right? Well, I hope so, after what we've talked about recently. If we love one another, we serve one another. Amen? When we start serving one another, we begin to discover things we are good at and things we are not good at. We begin to discover the talents that God has given us to edify the body, to help the body. So many of you in here are really excellent at that. You serve the church without anybody having to tell you, and you're good at it. It's gifted to you. Somebody makes breakfast for us every Sunday morning. Is that not a gift from God? I know that's kind of funny, but I'm being serious. That person loves us so much that he serves us every single morning by preparing us meals. Is that not a talent? Is that not a gift from God? Is that not a conviction of the Holy Spirit? When we love one another and we desire to serve one another, you'll find that our special talents, our spiritual gifts, will often be revealed as we desire to serve and to love one another. Then he goes on to say, but especially that you may prophesy. For one who speaks in a tongue does not speak to men, but to God. For no one understands, but in his spirit he speaks mysteries. But one who prophesies speaks to men for edification and exhortation and consolation. One who speaks in a tongue edifies himself, but one who prophesies edifies the church. Now I wish that you all spoke in tongues, but even more that you would prophesy. And greater is one who prophesies than the one who speaks in tongues, unless he interprets, so that the church may receive edifying. I want to point out that Paul is not, he's not trying to cause divisions. And he's not trying to get them to desire one gift over the other, so that they, because that was their problem to begin with, was that they were going after certain spiritual gifts because they wanted to be involved in that ecstatic experience. He's not doing that. What he's pointing out is he's pointing out the benefits of prophesying in a church as opposed to speaking in tongues. How is prophesying better than speaking in tongues in a church setting? Well, in a church setting, to prophesy comes from the Greek word prophetēo, which literally translates to I declare the will of God. It literally means to speak forth the will of God. It is not necessarily about the future. Many of us, when we hear the word prophecy or to prophesy, we immediately associate it with some kind of fortune telling. In fact, there's a place that Nicole and I pass. It's kind of out in the middle of nowhere, but it's in between Troy and Valdosta. And I see it and I can't help but laugh, but it's got a hand up there with the eye, and then the sign says, Christian Palm Reading. Christian palm reading and fortune telling. And I want to go up to that person and I'm going to say, what are you doing? Do you read the Bible? I encourage you all, when you go home today, to go turn to Deuteronomy 18 and read Deuteronomy 18. Don't point that up there. Deuteronomy 18, go home and study it for yourself. So to prophesy does not necessarily mean to tell somebody's future, but it means to declare the will of God, to speak forth the will of God. For the local church, and this is what Paul is trying to get, for them to learn the will of God was infinitesimally more beneficial than hearing a language that they didn't know. Infinitesimally, for them to learn from the scriptures, for them to learn what is God's will for them in that church, was infinitesimally more important than for them to hear somebody speak a language that they did not know. That is why, in the context of the local church, to prophesy is greater than to speak in tongues. And yet, we go to a lot of these charismatic churches, and we find that they will tell you that the evidence of your salvation is that you speak in tongues. That is the height. That is their view of tongues. That it is such a high view. I have been told that if I cannot speak in, I'm speaking from experience. I'm not trying to be hateful. I'm just telling you. I have been told that if I do not speak in tongues, that means I do not have the Holy Spirit. You might as well just say what you're thinking. If I don't speak in tongues, I'm not saved. But that scripture nowhere teaches that. Nowhere. Romans chapter 8, we learn that those who belong to Christ Jesus have the Spirit of God. If you do not have the Spirit of God, you do not belong to Christ Jesus. If you belong to Christ, brothers and sisters, the Holy Spirit lives inside of you today. And He works in you and He empowers you to do His will. For us today, the way in which we prophesy is by reading and teaching the Bible, God's infallible word. You ever thought about this? If the word to prophesy means to declare the will of God, and somebody stands up here and literally reads the Bible to you, which is the word of God, what is that person doing? In 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16 through 17, it says this, all scripture is inspired by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be adequate. highlight this last sentence here, equipped for every good work. The scriptures are sufficient. The scriptures are sufficient. It has all the instructions that we as followers of Christ will ever need. All the instructions that we as followers of Christ will ever need. If we believe this, and we also believe that the scriptures were completed at John's revelation around 96 AD, then we ought to stop seeking for voices and wondering why God is silent if when we come home, we don't read our Bible. If you want to hear God's word, if you want to have the gift of prophecy, open the Bible and read it, and you'll find that God speaks to you through the words He has written on the page. Because those are His words. Not mine, not man's, His. Scripture is sufficient. Today, we ought to earnestly desire to prophesy by devoting ourselves to the careful and consistent study of God's holy word, the Bible. I told my wife, I said, we have a lot. I'll try to go fast, though. John MacArthur, he makes this statement in this book. It's called Charismatic Chaos. He says, many charismatics point out that the KJV of 1 Corinthians 14, which is what we're reading. By the way, I'm not knocking KJV. Listen to me. I have a KJV Bible. I love it. But I just want you to listen to what I'm saying here. Many charismatics point out that the KJV of 1 Corinthians 14 repeatedly uses the expression an unknown tongue. That, they say, describes a language that is not of this world. However, listen to me, the unknown part was supplied by translators, and it does not appear in the Greek text. If you have your King James Bible, I want you to look. That is why in the KJV it shows the word unknown in italics. When something is in italics in the Bible, that means that it has been implied. But it does not exist in the original Greek text. Now, that's not to say the KJV is wrong, but it's important for us to understand the context that if it's an unknown tongue, what Paul is saying is that it's unknown to the church. It's unknown to those who are hearing it. In verse 6 through 12 of 1 Corinthians 14, but now, brethren, if I come to you speaking in tongues, what will I profit you unless I speak to you either by way of revelation, or of knowledge, or of prophecy, or of teaching, yet even lifeless things, either flute or harp, and producing a sound, if they do not produce a distinction in the tones, how will it be known what is played on the flute or on the harp? For if the bugle produces an indistinct sound, he will prepare himself for battle. So also you, unless you utter by the tongue speech that is clear, how will it be known what is spoken? For you will be speaking into the air. There are perhaps a great many kinds of languages in the world, and no kind is without meaning. If then I do not know the meaning of a language, I'll be to the one who speaks a barbarian, and the one who speaks will be a barbarian to me. So also you, since you are zealous of spiritual gifts, seek to abound for the edification of the church. In this passage, Paul illustrates the uselessness of speaking in tongues in a local church setting. And we've already talked about why it's useless. He says, if the bugle produces an indistinct sound, who prepare himself for battle? What he's talking about there is that they would often sound horns when they were going to war, but it was a specific sequence. And I'm sure we've heard this. We do the same thing today with our military. You know, we've got that. Anybody who's in here in the military can tell me what this is. But you know, well, that's a specific sequence that lets people know, I think, to get up in the morning. I could be wrong, but I believe that's what that is. And then you have another sequence. Da-da, 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 da-da. And that means something else. There's a sequence for retreat. There's a sequence for charge. There's a sequence for death, which we call taps. All of those are different sequences of the bugle. The bugle doesn't have keys. So what he's saying here is that if the bugle just utters something, but it is not in uniform, it's useless. How will people know what to do? Likewise, brothers and sisters, when you and I are in here and we are encouraging one another, if I come up to you speaking a language you don't know, I'm just edifying myself. I'm making myself seem smart. but it's not useful to the body. Then finally, verse 13 through 19, therefore let one who speaks in a tongue pray that he may interpret, for if I pray in a tongue, my spirit prays, but my mind is unfruitful. What is the outcome then? I will pray with the spirit, and I will pray with the mind also. I will sing with the spirit, and I will sing with the mind also. Otherwise, if you bless in the spirit only, how will the one who fills the place of the ungifted say the amen at your giving thanks, since he does not know what you are saying? For you are giving thanks well enough, but the other person is not edified. I thank God I speak in tongues more than you all. However, in the church I desire to speak 5 words with my mind, so that I might instruct others also, rather than 10,000 words in a tongue. Can I tell you something? This is the only instance in which praying in a tongue is used, and Paul is not using it in a positive light. Nowhere in the Bible are we instructed to pray in tongues. But what about Romans 8, 26 through 27? What about Romans 8, 26 through 27? What does Romans 8, 26 through 27 say? It says, in the same way, the Spirit also helps our weaknesses, for we do not know how to pray as we should, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And he who searches the hearts knows what the mind of the Spirit is, because he intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. You may read that and say there's evidence that we ought to pray in tongues, and that when the Spirit intercedes for us and that the Spirit helps us, then it is in a language we don't understand, because it's written in groanings too deep for words. However, if that is your interpretation of what it means to pray in the Spirit, that the Holy Spirit puts forth unintelligible utterances through you, let's look at Ephesians chapter 6, verse 18. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 18 says this, with all prayer and petition, pray at all times in the what? In the Spirit. Pray at all times in the Spirit. And with this in view, be on the alert with all perseverance and petition for all the saints. If your interpretation of praying in the Spirit means that you pray in unintelligible utterances, and Ephesians 6, 18 tells us to pray always in the Spirit, then you ought never to pray in an intelligible language, but you ought always to pray in tongues. Of course, praying in the Spirit could have another meaning. It could mean that every time we pray, the Holy Spirit helps us. In fact, it is because the Holy Spirit is inside of us that we are able to communicate with God. Folks, I'm telling you all this because I don't want you to be deceived. I personally, I've lost some friends because I didn't know what I'm teaching you today. And when I learned this, the friends that I had were so entrenched in the charismatic movement that they just couldn't be around me anymore. My prayer is that you take what I have shown you today through the Scripture, and that you study it for yourself, and that if you have any questions, I want you to come up to me. In just a moment, we're going to have a hymn of decision. And I promise that I'm going to work on my timing so that we don't keep getting out this late. But in just a moment, we're going to have a hymn of decision. If you have never surrendered your sins to God, if you have never accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, then I pray that you will do that today. That you would realize that there's nothing good you could do to come to God, but the only thing that you can do is to come to the one who did all the good for you. He took your sins, Jesus, on the cross, and he died, paying the atoning sacrifice on your behalf. And then he rose again 3 days later, having victory over death. And brothers and sisters, he extends that victory, that wonderful victory over sin and over death, to all who would but believe in him and call upon him as Lord. If you haven't done that, then I pray that you would do that today. If we could get some deacons to come forward.